हमारा दिख नहीं रहा है वैसे अच्छे से ना, ऐसा करना चाहिए। हाय हेलो, सो एवरी फ्यू 50 years, 100 years और मे बी अ कपल ऑफ 100 years द एंटायर सिस्टम वुड गेट कंप्लीटली रिशफल्ड एंड देन the set of people who believed in one particular religion or one particular god, they established their own rule, they established their own currency, they established their own set of principles on which apparently the entire region or their kingdom would be run according to. So the question that you ask me is that the answer to that question in this essence is that what I'm trying to say is Hinduism is see, whenever you attach ism to something, it becomes extreme. For example, yeah, when you talk about a capitalistic economy, I'm like, okay, cool. Capitalistic economy basically speaks about the purchasing power of a consumer. It talks about the individual rights of a citizen. It talks about the fact that every citizen is equal, and that everyone should get an equal opportunity, or rather everyone should earn and have a living and have a standard of living according to their own capacity. So however, whatever skill sets you have, you will earn that much. You either do a business or you do a job accordingly, aapka standard of living waisa hoga, consecutively you will have that kind of a life. So in that sense, everybody gets an equal opportunity in a capitalistic economy. In a communistic economy or in countries where the principle of communism exists, not communism but the principle of communism, what they say is everyone is equal in the eye of the law, and no one is greater, no one is smaller, so the division of resources should be equal amongst everyone. And the state is above the citizens, and the state functions for the betterment of the citizens. So a capitalistic economy says that the country will grow as long as there is individual growth, and everyone should be given their freedom to choose whatever they want to do, and that is how the economy grows. Communism says, or the communism based economy says, that you should provide everyone with equal resources and there should not be any inequality. Now when we talk about capitalism, it goes to another extreme, and then you say that no matter what, how much ever economic inequality exists, that is still the right thing, because survival of the fittest is the key mantra. And when you talk about communism, you say that no matter how highly talented or full or how highly talented or no matter how much potential a person has, even then there would be total equality. So for a person who has tremendous potential, there would actually be a loss of potential or loss of opportunity to that person in communism. So when an ism is attached to something, it is always extremism. Okay. Extreme left-wing political parties, extreme right-wing political parties, they generally do not appeal to the intellectual public. So ism in itself indicates something extreme. So when you say that Hinduism, you are basically trying to, or any person is trying to say that Hindu is a religion which is the most supreme of the religions. The beautiful paradox, sorry, the beautiful contradiction to this thing itself lies in the fact that you could be a Nastic, or you could be a person who is completely non-believing in the concept of God or in the concept of one particular creator who is responsible for creating this entire universe, which we called as an atheist, and yet you could be associated or identified to be as a Hindu.
Right.
No other religion, according to my knowledge, gives you the freedom or the individual ability to say openly that I don't adhere to any principle that this religion, so-called religion, asks me or compels me to adhere to, and still I am belonging to that religion. So I am disregarding all the principles of this religion, but still I am open to say that I belong to this religion. No other religion normally does that. The reason is that in its essence, Hinduism is not ism. It is just Hindu, and it is not a religion, but it is a philosophy. There will always be extremists, and there will always be people inclined to an extreme ideology which say that it is ism and it is extreme, but it is totally not. And that is why every household in India that you go to, they'll pray to their different set of gods, which will ultimately be clubbed into one common frame of principles or a civilization called as the Hindu philosophy. That is why they say that this is the Hindu philosophy. The people, I mean, forget everyone else. Swami Vivekananda, in case you guys haven't listened to his famous speeches when he had given the famous speech in the Chicago, in the world, what was it? It was the World Religion Conglomerate, if my memory serves me correctly. Swami Vivekananda, who is considered to be the postulate or the poster boy of a modern Hindu religion, he had gone on to say on record that Hindu is a philosophy, it is not a religion. And we are such that we are ready to assimilate everyone that wants to join us without a bias towards anyone. Now, coming back specifically to your question, again, no religion is good or bad, and every philosophy has some good points and some bad points. But if you consider the differentiating point, the point is that in 70 to 80% of other religions, there will be one person who tells the other followers that this is okay to do, this is not okay to do. In its essence, first of all, Hindu philosophy does not have that fixed one person. Some may point the finger to Ram, some others may point it to Krishna, others may point it to Gautam Buddha, others may point it to Ganpati or Shankar or Vishnu. The list goes on. Or you could go towards saints like Kabir, Tulsidas, Ramdas, Tukaram, Jnaneswar, whatnot. But still, you cannot say that this is exactly the thing that Hindu philosophy tells. This is the only thing that Hindu philosophy tells. Nobody can be sure about it. And nobody, किसी ने ठेका नहीं लेके रखा है हिंदी में हम बोलते हैं ना nobody has the copyrights exclusively or nobody can forcefully say with aplomb that look this is what the religion exactly says because it's not technically a religion in itself it is a philosophy and as a result of which the question that you asked the answer to that is there is no specific person there is no specific entity and there is no specific text to follow in our Hindu philosophy. There is an umbrella set of philosophy, and that philosophy is about more than compassion. It is simply about training the human mind and what feels appropriate to think and what doesn't feel appropriate to think. It is simply about that. Because if you see, there are subsets of this philosophy. Yoga is a philosophy, which is a subset of the Hindu philosophy. Jainism is a philosophy, which kind of is a subset of the Hindu philosophy. Even for that matter, many different sects or communities in North India, they have their own set of religion. But ultimately, the umbrella branch is again a philosophy, which is the Hindu philosophy. And when you talk about the philosophy, there is no one fixed philosopher ever. And there is no fixed set of philosophy ever. It is just a concept. It is like, it is borderless. You can expand it, but still you know that there will be certain limits to it. It is that. And that is the reason that there is no fixed person, and ultimately you cannot say that this only is prescribed in the Hindu philosophy. Just to give you an example, we have a lot of communities in India, in this Indus Valley civilization even now, who cannot live without eating meat. And there are those who cannot even stand the smell of roots like garlic, onion, and beetroot and whatnot.
Right.
Still, we all are Hindus. So their community is a very small tributary or a sub branch of the larger philosophy of called as the Hindu philosophy. If you look at other religions, they will always say that you are allowed to drink this, but you are not allowed to wear that. You are allowed to eat this, but if you eat that, then you do not belong to this religion. For that matter, even after a person dies, in the Hindu philosophy, there are thousands of different ways in which one person can get cremated, depending upon the stream of thought or the community that person belongs to. In other religions, there will be one fixed view. So you cannot have, I mean, at least in my knowledge, you won't have a philosophy that is more encompassing and more elastic and flexible than this. But the sad part is, unfortunately, one stream of thought, and it's like, see, it exists on different planes, and many a times the planes do not intersect and they are not even parallel. But the problem with people who just want to oppose for the sake of opposing, suppose, for political gains or for social gains or for otherwise, the problem with these people is that they systematically take something out of this plane, then they systematically take something out of this plane, they systematically take something out of this plane, they club all these three things together, and then they say, like, look, this is the problem. That is why this is a very bad thing to do, and this is where we talk about. If you take things out of context, they will look bad. But they do not belong to the same plane.
Right.
So you have to understand the context.
Manipulate the entire Hinduism and
forget that also. If you forget that also, just if you want to be intellectual and honest enough with your own self, to all the people who are watching this podcast, I will openly say, again, close your eyes, forget that you belong to the particular religion that you belong to. Think like you are a third person, and then analyze your religion, and you will notice 3 to 4 things that are absurd, that do not make sense, that are stupid, and that they are downright regressive in some manner to a particular, it could be to a particular gender, it could be to a particular community within your religion, it could be to people who have joined your religion late. So what religion tries to do simply is it tries very hard in its own way to bring people together under one common umbrella. But the problem is the people who say that they know that religion, the moment any person says that, and they say that, look, this is said in the text, na? This is said in the text, so it has to be true. Are you but stupid idiots? That text was written 3,000 years ago.
Right.
3,000 years ago or 2,000 years ago, people thought that Earth is the center, Sun is revolving around the Earth. So you have to cannot take things out of context, one, and you should not be stupid enough to admit everything that a religion says. Because if that is the case, you might as well take a lighter and just burn off your degrees, trash your laptops, and just go join a particular cult if you're that stupid. Because no religion is perfect. Ultimately, every religion, when you go towards the extreme side of any damn religion in the world, the propagators of that particular any religion, or even philosophy for that matter, will always tell you that this is the only truth. So if you want to survive, if you truly want to know what the universe means, you better join us. If you don't join us, you are doomed. And that is the most ridiculous and stupid thing to say, but it is even stupider if you are actually naive enough to admit to that thing. So this
is what also funny how, So how you said that even if a person is an atheist, he can call himself a Hindu because of how Hinduism is actually a philosophy and not a religion. But it's also funny that if I go up and say that I'm an atheist or I don't believe in God, then I am frowned upon. People are like, how can you say it? So it is also a point of concern if you talk about this particular topic. Because obviously an atheist is not a bad person, right? He just doesn't really reciprocate with the values and with the religion and whatever is done in name of the religion. Just for example, going visiting to a temple every day or once or twice in a week in the particular significant days of a week. So a person is not doing that. Even if a person is not lighting the diya every day, even that person is frowned upon. But that doesn't mean that he or she is not really believing in a power that is way, way more higher than and superior than us. So I think that's also a very point in this time.
See, I'll ask you one question. In essence, what do you do when you don't feel physically well? What do you do?
Physically well, I might just rest.
Well, you have a, well, okay. I'll give you a better example. Have fever to the range of 103. So it's not something that you can afford to take lightly. In normal situations, forget the current corona times, normal situations. What would you do? What would normally a person do?
I would go to a doctor if I think it's really alarming. I would go to a doctor, get the medication and take adequate amount of rest.
Absolutely. So, which doctor would you go to? Which type of doctor?
Physician. General physician.
Right.
Just a fever.
Right. So, there are people in this world, if they had 103 degree Fahrenheit fever, some people would say that I believe in my immunity or I believe in my physical ability to heal. Let me just rest and I'll be okay. Some others would say it is a great cause of concern. They'll panic and or they might not panic as well. They would prefer going to a doctor. Again, going to a doctor, some might prefer Ayurvedic, some might prefer allopathic, others might go to a homeopathic doctor, others might go to some other form of medicine, say Chinese medicine. Now, the people in the second category who go to their respective doctors, according to probability, there is a 50% chance they go there, they feel better, they come back. Like not instantaneously, they go there, they come back, they take their medicines, they feel better. 50% chance, right. Nothing of this happens. Suppose a person goes to allopathic doctor. The fever doesn't reduce. That person thinks, okay, let me try Ayurvedic. The person goes there, doesn't reduce. Goes to homeopathic, probably might reduce. That person starts believing in homeopathy now. That person was believing in allopathy. That person started believing in homeopathy. And you could draw 20 different permutation combinations to the one scenario that I just mentioned right now. All right. Point I'm trying to make is any kind of a religion is ultimately based on belief.
Right.
And if the belief is there, it is there. If it is not there, it's not there. the whole point of you going to the doctor in the first place was to make you feel better, to make yourself feel better.
Correct.
Simply, if you had the willpower that you knew or you had the belief that your immune system will take care of that thing, and maybe it could have been a serious thing, there again is a 50% chance that you might get better. There is a 50% chance you might not get better. But still, there is a high chance that you will continue believing in yourself. So what is this? In this case, you're believing in yourself. A religion in its entirety is simply that doctor which tries to provide you with a certain medication in order for your mind to feel at peace. At least any religion should be. The very reason why any religion should exist or started existing in the first place is that. I'll give you my own personal example, because if I started to explain this thing in a generalistic manner, it becomes very complicated. Mm-hmm. On a personal level, I am a big devotee of Lord Ganesha. Mm-hmm. And since I belong to the typical Maharashtrian Puneri community, we guys celebrate Ganesh festival or Ganesh Utsav with even greater fervor and aplomb. It's just a community thing, or it's just how we have been brought up. We have seen Ganesh pandals and just people who have Ganesh idols at their place during the Ganesh festival. So it is something that is ingrained in my brain. It's just like Diwali ke time patake kaise bajate aur wo farar kaise khate, waise Ganesh festival hai to Ganpati ki murti aake rakhni. Fir thode se bade ho gaye 4-5 saal ke, to mom dad ne bola ki ye karna kyun, matlab excitement to thi as a kid, but ye karna zaruri kyun hai, aur uska symbolical bhi nahi, unhone physical significance hi bola usko. Kyun hai? Kyunki Ganpati is considered to be the god of intelligence. So Ganpati ke acche se puja archa karoge us 10 din mein, aur Ganpati ka naam aur mom dad ka kaam aisa system hota hai ki dekho Ganpati bhagwan bolenge to aisa karo, padhai karo acche se, unhone kaise padhai karke unka sir bada ho gaya type blah 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 blah. So okay, fine. So as a kid, two things that got stuck in my head. One was Ganpati Bhagwan is the god of intelligence, or the lord of intelligence, or the supreme lord of thought in general. And second is that if I don't study, Ganpati Bhagwan mujh pe gussa honge. Jaisa main bada ho gaya, aur jaisa main ye kitab actually padhne laga, main kitab likhne laga, or the thought of writing this book came to my mind. By the way, interesting fact. A majority of this book is actually written during the Ganesh festival of 2018. I just realized this fact while speaking. So, like from 2012 or 13, matlab jab main 22-23 umar cross karke aage ja raha tha, mujhe genuinely realize ho gaya ki the only reason aaj bhi main utna hi pyar karta hu Ganpati se, aaj bhi. But the very reason why I respect Ganpati as a deity in particular is because I am a very common human being on this planet, and I am not spiritually and philosophically uplifted like the prophets or Jesus or Buddha or Sant Jnaneshwar, Sant Ramdas, Guru Gobind Singh, or many, many other things. And I know it. I'm a very simple, bahut hi mamooli insaan hoon, jiska thought process bhi bahut limited hai. But because, so what happens is when you know that you are a very common person, and when you know that your thought process doesn't go beyond the point, but still you want to make sure that you are disciplined and focused in whatever you do, and you do not roam about or roam in the direction of bad habits, be it addictions, be it just whiling away your time, be it not utilizing your potential, or being just a bad person in general or whatever, and not doing those things and doing the things that really matter and are good. You cannot, everyone knows, right? Everyone knows exercise karna zaruri hai. Everyone knows subah time pe uthna chahiye. Aur sab ready hoke kuch achha padho, ye karo, wo karo. Everyone knows that. Addictions nahi karne chahiye. But obviously people fall into those traps.
Right.
And people fall into those traps. Why do people say that bad habits are easy to acquire? Because bad habits basically aren't bad intrinsically. They are just the twisted side of the human mind where the mind wants to go but normally wouldn't go. So it is essentially one side of the same coin. It is like I have the phobia of heights, but even then jab valley dikhti hai to main aisa dekhta hu upar se aur fir mere pet mein kuch to hone lagta hai. So what is that? Wo jo keeda rehta hai na, wo hum keeda hum sab mein rehta hai, right? And what really happens is for us to not get steered away in the wrong direction, either you can be, your mind should be so crystal clear and should be so uplifted that no matter the distraction, you shouldn't get distracted by all these things and you should just do the things that matter. But aisa itna aasan to nahi hai na mind ko train karna. So you need an external stimulus jisko dekh ke, because in humans three things are a very great callback and they are also great reminders. Out of them, one is the auditory reminders. When you hear something, when you hear a particular song, for example, you already have associated it with a memory from your childhood.
Right.
Doesn't it happen to you? It happens to me 1,000 times with 1,000 different yeah. songs. Right. Same is with this. This is the strongest sense of emotion. This is the strongest sense of memory, by the way. Memory of smell. People think this or this is the strongest, but actually this is the strongest. Because whatever you hear, if you don't hear it for 50 years, you might not recollect it fast. Vision is the one of the weakest, by the way.
Yeah.
Because if you happen to see the same thing 5 or 10 years after, and even if that thing is the same, you will feel that it has changed a little bit. Because your visual memory is not that good, actually, at least for humans. I don't know for animals, kitna achha. This is the greatest and the most perfect storage of memory. So what I'm trying to tell you is, jab mere ghar pe aaj matlab har saal Ganpati aata hai, what I do is I basically know that the thing, the mitti ka jo bhi murat that is in front of me, is basically a symbolical representation of all the good virtues that I want to imbibe in myself. But being a human, I will have at least lakhs and crores of doing the wrong things or doing the things that should not be done by me, which are exactly the opposite of the virtues that I would like to have, which are represented in the idol of the Ganpati. So, in essence, the Murti Puja or the idol worship that many other people from many different other religions and even atheists in Hindu religion have, or Hindu philosophy have an objection against. How can you say that wo idol mein, wo murti mein bhagwan hai, wo idol mein there is a spiritual something or bhagwan ka ek soul ka ek part hai. It is not that. The idol is of course made by rock, made of rock, wood, cement, plaster of Paris, mud, whatever. It is the idea behind that idol. And the thought is basically, kyun bolte hai? If you think about it from a very logical angle, kyun bolte hai Ganpati ko the god of intelligence? Because ultimately, which human being would not want to enhance their thinking capacity? Because our world isn't outside, the world that humans actually live is uska length of 6 inches hai. We live between our ears.
Right.
Our entire world and our entire perception of our own world is just between this space of 6 inches. But this space is the hardest to control. And to imbibe the virtues that we know are right, but we cannot have them easily because of the human limitation. It is an exercise of training your mind to do the right thing, which is symbolically represented in the idol of Ganesha. You want to achieve that level of perfection, that level of goodwill, that level of purity and essence in every possible way, which you know 100% can never be achieved, but still you try to go there. The problem is when people forget this exact aspect of any idol worship. Hanuman may or may not have existed ever in life. The point is not Hanuman sach mein the ya nahi. Aaj ke pagal log Ganesh Utsav mein गणपति आइडल के सामने 50 फीट दूर लंबा लाउडस्पीकर का वो लगाएंगे वॉल, उसके आगे पूरे ड्रग्स करेंगे गंदे गंदे वाले और नंगे नाचेंगे फॉर द विसर्जन मिरोनु. यू आर एब्सोल्युटली बीटिंग द एंटायर पर्पस. इन एनी वे फॉरगेट. मान लो गणपति एज एन एंटिटी डजंट एग्जिस्ट. मैं तो बोलता हूँ मान लो. मैं भी कभी कभी सोचता हूँ कि नहीं, ऑब्वियसली मेरे लिए तो बहुत प्रैक्टिकल है, मैं जो नहीं हूँ वो मैं ढूंढने की कोशिश करता हूँ. एंड इट इज अल्टीमेटली इट इज अ मार्क ऑफ रिस्पेक्ट फॉर द क्रिएशन, बिकॉज बियॉन्ड द बिग बैंग ऑल्सो देर वॉज टाइम विच वी डोंट टेक इन टू कंसिडरेशन, एंड इट इज जस्ट अ मार्क ऑफ रिस्पेक्ट फॉर द क्रिएटर जिसके बारे में हमको कुछ पता नहीं. इट इज अ मार्क ऑफ रिस्पेक्ट कि एज ह्यूमन बीइंग वी नो नथिंग. द मोर वी नो द मोर वी रियलाइज दैट वी नो नथिंग.
राइट राइट.
एंड इट इज जस्ट टू एम्बाइब दैट बेसिक प्रिंसिपल ऑफ ह्यूमिलिटी, दैट नो मैटर हाउ लॉन्ग वी गो इवन इन आवर थॉट, देयर आर थिंग्स व्हिच आर बियॉन्ड आवर परसीवेबल इमेजिनेशन. एंड बिकॉज ये कॉन्वर्सेशन जब होती है तभी हमको रियलाइज होता है दैट वी आर नथिंग इन द लार्जर कॉन्टेक्स्ट ऑफ थिंग्स, इज वेयर अ रिलीजन कम्स इन टू पिक्चर. सो उसका सिंबॉलिकल कॉन्टेक्चुअलाइजेशन समझ में आना चाहिए. लाइक आई वॉज टेलिंग यू द होल पॉइंट ऑफ हनुमान इज नॉट टू डिबेट वेदर हनुमान ट्रूली एग्जिस्टेड और नॉट. द पॉइंट ऑफ हनुमान इज दैट इफ यू डोंट ट्रीट योर बॉडी लाइक अ टेम्पल, you won't have a body that functions properly, and if you don't have a body that functions properly, you will die. You won't get to experience life because your life will be cut short. So be like Hanuman, who would first rever and respect their body like a temple. So the point of Hanuman is that aapko nahi jam raha hai na exercise karne ko. Look at that concept of Hanuman jinhone इतना बॉडी की तरफ ध्यान देके भी ही वॉज वन ऑफ द मोस्ट हम्बल बीइंग्स दैट इज देयर इन द हिंदू पुराण. यू हैव टू अंडरस्टैंड, ईच पर्सन हैज टू अंडरस्टैंड द वर्च्यू बिहाइंड दैट. लक्ष्मण सच में था या फेक था वो पॉइंट नहीं है. उसका भाई के प्रति प्यार क्या था वो देखो. ही लेफ्ट, दैट इज अगेन अ डिबेटेबल टॉपिक वेदर ही शुड हैव लेफ्ट हिज वाइफ फॉर हिज ब्रदर और नॉट. Let's not get into that, but the point is he was that much affectionate towards his brother that he didn't, it was not required of him to leave that kingdom, but somehow he felt that because mere bhai ke sath injustice hua hai mujhe jana chahiye. Ye qualities hai aur ye qualities ki taraf hi dhyan jana chahiye, na ki Ram sach mein the ya nahi. The entire point of our Puranas is just to explain to us ki kya hona chahiye aur क्या नहीं होना चाहिए. एंड इट इज नॉट प्रीची, दे टेल यू दैट इवन दोज बीइंग्स हु वर कंसिडर्ड टू बी परफेक्ट, इवन दे स्क्रूड अप बिग टाइम, बट देन दैट इज द होल पॉइंट ऑफ लाइफ. यू विल स्क्रू अप 1000 times, बट स्टिल यू हैव टू गेट यूर सेल्फ बैक एंड जस्ट गो देर एंड ट्राई टू अचीव दैट लेवल ऑफ परफेक्शन एंड प्योरिटी. that is the entire point of idol worship and everything. So unless we truly contact that contextualization hits us, it's very hard. Then and ninety to ninety-five percent of the people who believe in idol worship or who believe in that God, they do so because of ritual. But they forget the thought behind that ritual. I'll tell you for a fact, Samartha Ramdas Swami, who wrote the Aarti of Ganpati as we know it in Maharashtra, that is, like Jai Deva, Jai Deva, Jai Mangala Murti, Darshana Matre Mana, Kamana Purti, Jai Deva, Jai Deva. This Aarti was written by Samartha Ramdas Swami, whose shloka I always read. So the shloka that Ganadesha Go Isha Sarva Gunanta, Moyarambha Arambha Se Nirgunanta. All these shlokas, the hymns of the mind, these are written by that same saint. Now this saint revered Lord Hanuman. And he realized that for me to achieve a philosophical level, I need to first develop my body and I should respect my body with complete humility. So he became a devotee of Lord Hanuman. He developed his body. And in spite of that fact, the biggest book that he wrote, which is called as the Dasa Bodh. Das refers to Samartha Ramdas Swami, who considers himself to be a servant of Ram. So Das is the servant of Ram. And Bodh is understanding that Samartha Ramdas Swami developed from his own thinking, which Ram gave him. So Das Bodh is basically his understanding, which was given to him by Ram. He doesn't say this understanding is mine. He says that was given to me by him when I started thinking. And do you know what is written in that? Some of the key points. The one key point that he has written is, in spite of the fact that he was unmarried, there is an entire chapter dedicated to couples and how after marriage they should behave with each other. And how wrong they can go while behaving with each other, and how they should not do those wrongs. Just daily attitudinal or behavioral characteristics, how they should respect each other and all those things, but in a slightly humorous manner. Furthermore, he has talked about Murkhanchi Lakshane. Murkha is obviously a stupid people, and Lakshane is the signs of stupid people. And he got all these things just by looking inside and understanding his own self and his own existence better. He never claimed knowledge over that information or that epiphany in any way. He always said that this was given to me by those things. And it was not even ki bhagwan ko phool chadao, unke charno mein matha teko, ye kuch nahi hai. He just tells people what practically you should do in your life and how you should not behave stupidly. How you should manage your expenses right. These are the simple things that he has told, sometimes in a humorous way and sometimes in a very serious way. So the point I'm trying to make is that the person who developed the Aarti of Lord Ganpati is the same person who tells people how to behave in a practical manner. And this saint belonged to the 17th century, 1630, I think he was born, if my memory serves me correctly. So these people also were way ahead in their thought process. They knew what to take and they understood what the symbolism was and how to use it for your own betterment. But the problem with future generations always lies in the fact that we forget the Sikh or the teaching and we just remember what needs to be done, and that needs to be done is nothing but the ritual. So we know the ritual, we know the person who told things which would end in this being a ritual. But ye dono important nahi hai, ye important hai beech wala. The teachings which we forget. So wow. that Yeah, so that is how things evolve, but iski taraf koi dhyan nahi deta hai, and that is the reason that we see majority stupidity going around. For example, aaj Ashadi Ekadashi thi, so people told me ki upvas karo. Maine bola okay fine, maine khichdi khai aur uske sath chakli khai. So koi bola ki chakli kyun khana hai, maine bola nahi khana, ye kahan likha hai.
Yeah, all of this is majorly, you know, coming from convenience or just about some kind of a belief that your ancestors had.
Problem is not the belief. Problem is blindly following the belief to make it a ritual. और ये नहीं करोगे तो वो बुरा मान जाएंगे. वो रहते भी नहीं है यहाँ पे कोई. पर उनके नाम पे बोलने वाले करोड़ों रहते हैं. अच्छा ये क्यों नहीं करना ये तो बताओ. वो तो पता ही नहीं है. वो तो 10 पीढ़ियां भूल गए ना हम लोग. लाइक श्रावण में नॉनवेज क्यों नहीं खाना है? बिकॉज़ इट इज अ ब्रीडिंग सीजन, सो यू माइट नॉट एज वेल हैव नॉनवेज. ये बताओ ना.
राइट राइट,
सिंपल रीजनिंग्स बताओ. कॉम्प्लिकेट क्यों कर रहे हैं?
उसके बाद आता है पेज नंबर 41 जहां पे तुम बोलते हो इंडियन फिलोसफी के बारे में. क्या कर रहे हो तुम? दे रहा ना.
चलो चैप्टर टू अरण्यकांड पंचवटी.
क्या था ये डबल चैप्टर टू?
अरे वो
चैप्टर टू
रीटेक लिया मैंने क्या.